Welcome to the Serious TV Drama Podcast with Scot and Dan. I'm Scot, and with me as always, the Kemper to my Holden, or should I say the Kemper to my Ford, because he's the exciting to my board, it's Dan. How you doing this evening, Dan? Have a happy new year.
Yes, it's a happy new year for me, and hopefully for you as well, good sir.
I just realized I said have a happy new year instead of just saying happy new year, so I guess I'm talking about 2019 already.
You could just be like, yeah, we got a couple days down, but enjoy the rest of your year, buddy.
Yeah, there you go. So we are trying to start things off with a smash here by cranking out some unexpected, perhaps for folks, podcasts. We are here tonight to talk about the Netflix series Mindhunter that we have both recently finished watching. And The moment I was into like the first episode or two, I was already wanted to get in touch with you and said, Dan, you've got to watch this series. It's so totally up your alley. So I am glad that you were able to find time over the last few weeks and get to it. So what did you think of the series overall?
I guess pleasantly surprised isn't exactly the correct thing to say about it, because your recommendation given on our previous several hour long podcast for the last year was a pretty strong one. I trust your judgment in these matters, at least. But it was very good. I don't tend to watch a lot of Netflix shows, so I really don't, you know, have much of an idea of like what to expect. I mean, you know, that's not saying much, but I don't watch a lot of Netflix shows, so I'm really not expecting extremely like good quality all the time. And this is, you know, better than I would expect, I suppose. I mean, David Fincher being attached to it helps, but pretty much across the board, it was better than I predicted it would be.
Yeah, I had a feeling that was going to be your take on it. And before we go any further, although anyone listening to this podcast, I'm sure, watched Mindhunter, just to give a simple rundown of it. It's a show that's about the early stages of the behavioral sciences division of the FBI. And we really focus mainly on these two men, Holden Ford and Bill Tench, who are, start coming up with the idea to go and visit different killers who have multiple victims under their belts, to try to get behind the psychology of them, to profile them as well as it may help them to catch future killers. At least that's the thing that manifests over the course of the series. I love the idea that these are the guys who actually coined the term, at least in the series, serial killer. One interesting thing to know about the series going into it is that obviously the killers that they're interviewing, these are based on actual serial killers, whether it be Edmund Kemper or Richard Speck, so on and so forth. These are all actual killers that are well known, and much like any fan obsession, there is a very considerable cult in this country, and has been for many decades, of people who are really into reading about, watching things about serial killers. It's one of those kind of true crime fan things that people have always really been into.
Americans definitely have proven that sociopaths and narcissists are somewhat appealing, especially last year. So.
Going to try to avoid that topic for the next couple podcasts, if at all possible. But yes. The other interesting thing to note, though, while the killers are the actual people we're talking about, like, Speck and all these other guys, these two men, they are based on two actual FBI agents. Holden Ford is based on the actual agent, Johnny Douglas, I think his name was. What I thought was really fascinating, and probably caught your eye and ear and whatnot, is that that's the same agent that Thomas Harris, the writer, used as his inspiration for the Will Graham character with the Hannibal Lecter stories and such. So once I realized it was that connection as well, I was like, oh, then Dan's really going to be into this, because we we know our affection for Hannibal and so on. And Bill Tench's character is also based on a real agent. I think his name is, I think it was like Richard Ressler, if I'm not mistaken. I don't have that written right in front of me, but I remember it was an alliterative name. So what's really interesting about the series is that, unlike most TV shows that we watch, whether it be on Netflix or cable or whatever, they don't. It doesn't have a very set, like, major overarching plot the way I think we might have expected the show was going to have. You know what I mean?
It doesn't. You know, we've seen a fair amount of TV and movies that are, you know, kind of related to this subject, not exactly the exact same, but close enough where, I mean, this isn't the least bit unfamiliar to us, but, I mean, this doesn't seem like the kind of show where they're going to have one season with, like, you know, a big, you know, one bad serial killer for the whole season. It just kind of feels like the story is just kind of, you know, just kind of tumbled into the next one and just kind of flow together in whatever way they do it, instead of just having a really set, defined structure. So it's kind of, you know, less predictable than we're used to being able to do for this kind of thing.
Right. I mean, I think you go into a series that's about FBI agents and serial killers, you expect that to a certain extent it's going to be about, well, who's the big killer that they're going to be spending most of the season hunting down? And that doesn't really exactly happen in the show. However, they do ladle in details throughout the series, and it actually became, by the time we got to the end of the series, from what I understand, it became kind of a mildly polarizing element of the show. In several episodes, we are shown little glimpses of a man who, you know, if you go by the credits, he's listed simply as the ADT salesman. ADP or ADT?
ADT. Technician or something,
All the way up to the point where, when the series ends and the finale, the last moment is with that character, not with Holden as we might have expected. I think the last shot is him, burning the drawings or something.
That sounds right.
Okay, but we never really do anything with that character other than to see these little bits of him, and obviously we get the sense of, oh, there's something wrong here. There's something creepy about this guy. And for those people who know their true crime and know their killers, and I do to a certain extent, I don't consider myself an expert, but I remember reading a bunch of these publications called Murder Casebook, which would profile all these nutcases. I started to suspect who he was. The Kansas thing was kind of kicking in for me. For some reason, that area of the country really seems to be a hotbed for serial killers, I've noticed over the years. It seems extremely likely, I would even say like 90-95% likely, that character is actually based on who is known as the BTK killer, whose name was Dennis Rader. BTK, for anyone who doesn't know who that is, and that might be many people listening, the BTK killer, BTK stood for Bind, Torture, Kill. So it's an interesting choice. The actor looks very much like him. All the little things we're seeing the guy do in these people's homes and who he works for, it's the same thing that guy did. It's pretty clear that's who this character must be. But it's an odd choice if you go into the history of that character. And it makes me think, beyond the fact they're going to have they're changing history a little bit, which is fine. This isn't a documentary. It suggests that the show is either A, already anticipates having a pretty healthy long lifespan, or there's going to be some major time jumps in if it's only going to be like a couple seasons or something. To be specific, in case, just so people know what I'm talking about, Dennis Rader, that killer, he killed several people in the 70s. His last couple murders were in 1977. And then he doesn't kill anybody again until the mid-80s. Kills a couple people in the mid-80s. And then he takes another long sabbatical and doesn't kill anybody yet again until the early 90s, in which case he's later subsequently caught. So if you're featuring him in your first season, little pieces of him, it's giving me the impression that they're anticipating this series is going to take these characters all the way up until the early 90s and somehow make it that they have a strong hand in helping to catch him, even if that's not really what happened, but they can get away with that. But
Yeah,
that's what I'm thinking they're doing.
I wonder if like having like bigger names attached to the project, maybe they're able to get like a better deal from Netflix, because Fincher was involved and somebody else, I can't remember who at the moment, that I noticed in the credits, just like, oh, they're involved in this. But so maybe they're able to, get a 2 or 3 season deal right off the bat, and then they're able to kind of, set this up. So I'm sure while we thought that that might be a storyline that the our heroes, or sometimes less than heroic heroes, would be getting involved with by the end of the season, but it did not happen at all. So I don't have any problem with that whatsoever. I'm patient, but I
It
guess,
didn't. Yeah, it didn't bother me either. I mean, the final episode is a strange final episode in many ways. And I was staring at the screen a little bit when that happened when it ended that way. But it wasn't like a negative thing. It was just like more kind of a huh. Okay, it's. I'll give the show credit once again because it already had followed a line that I wasn't quite expecting as I watched the show, which made me that much more interested in it. And by ending that way, it was like, oh, okay. I also wasn't expecting it to end that way, which kind of made me more interested in it. Part of the ending I did see coming to a certain extent, maybe not the way they presented it in the episode. It didn't surprise me, for example, just before that happens, we see Holden having what a bit of a breakdown. I don't know if he's just having some sort of wacky panic attack or something, or if it's a bigger deal. But it seemed to me that whole episode was leading up to, and the last several episodes were leading up to him kind of falling apart, both personally and professionally. So that didn't come as a big surprise to me.
No, it's totally, probably could see something like that coming for quite a while. And he's just pretty much been a complete asshole almost the entire time. So I'm okay with him having some rough patches here, I guess.
Yeah, I it's a very it's he's a very Holden Ford's a very interesting character because it definitely excuse me they definitely alternate between the likability of the character and because he does do and say a lot of things that make you shake your head and it's almost how someone who seems to come from a somewhat maybe not sheltered. But a bit more of a pure background, although the hints we get about his family and his parents make you wonder. That's actually one of the interesting things about the series. I kind of wonder about his family, about his relationship with his mother, who he loves to talk to. But the only story we never see that happen, and the only story we ever hear is that she once caught him masturbating, so which is an odd thing to mention. When that's all you get about a character's background, that's kind of a strange thing. Also, the fact that we never hear anything about his father, also kind of strange. Because when he's profiling all these killers, well, one of the biggest things about them is their relationships with their parents. So that's why and considering the way the show kind of has it set up to whether there's any kind of parallel between them, in any way, shape, or form, then you start looking at what facts we know about Holden and his family and the type of person he is, why he can say certain words and not realize how unseemly or offensive that is, even though it seemed like the last thing he would say when you see him in another context. It's an interesting character, I thought.
Yeah, to me, he's kind of like Mulder. If Mulder had like no charm or like ability to like, smooth talk anybody whatsoever, that's just kind of how Holden Ford strikes me. No,
No, no
he's pretty
charm.
intuitive and can figure out some stuff, but he doesn't. He's not very. He's he lacks a good deal of charm.
Never really thought about the charm factor with his character. Yeah, maybe. I'd have to think about that. But you're right. I mean, he doesn't have that easy way with people, or a way of approaching the way even his partner does. Because
No.
Although in a lot of ways, Bill, is it Bill Tench?
Yeah.
It's another character I really like because it could have played very cliched.
Right.
The older, wiser guy who's seen it all before, and but now he's going to learn from this young buck kind of a thing. And that's probably another really good thing about the series is that this could have been a really cliched, buddying between these two, and they kind of. While it dips into it here and there, I think they really do a better job of avoiding that. And I think one of the
Yeah.
ways they do it is, number one, what you just said about Holden's character is that there's always something somewhat off-putting about him anyway, that he doesn't have quite the charm that, that say Fox Mulder does or something like that. And with Bill's character, you realize there it's not just the fact that he's got that situation at home with his kid. It's just that there are certain aspects of this work that he does believe in, but but you can see that he's kind of what's the word I'm looking for? He's torn quite often on it.
Yeah.
He's just a very interesting character, and I really like the dynamic between those two. It made it again one of those things that made it a much more appealing show to watch than I expected.
Well, yeah, it's really nice for us to see something like this that just, I mean, it just plays out in an unexpected way that kind of feels, I mean, fresh. I mean, they have all these actors that we really haven't seen in a lot of stuff, and they're just, I mean, and they managed to get just rock solid performances out of pretty much everybody you see on screen. I mean, we're seeing some, I mean, it just feels like we're watching, a true top, top-notch TV show here.
Oh,
And
yeah.
it's, I'm not particularly surprised about that, but I mean, it just, you're seeing all these people just, like we've seen Bill Tench, we've seen him in a few things. And of course, Anna Torv, who I didn't even know was going to be in the show until she showed up, obviously. But a lot of the other actors, I haven't seen much stuff, and I'm sure you've seen them in a few things here and there. But I think we're seeing, really solid work from a lot of people that we haven't heard of before this moment. That plus the way that the source, they're using the source material in this kind of weird way that doesn't feel inorganic, but still, like they're not going out of their way to do something different, but it just feels different. It's kind of nice.
I think what really works for it is, like you said, I mean, they build out a really good cast, but this isn't a star-driven show. But, I mean, Jonathan Groff is the main character, Holden Ford, but he's someone that if people know him, they know him either from a few seasons on Glee or for his stage acting. I mean, he's more known for, lighter musicals and comedies than anything else. So, which makes him an interesting choice in this part. Oh, and when you mentioned Anna Torv, I really liked her in this
Yeah.
series. And I liked that she was so very different than the character that I was used to seeing her play on Fringe all those years. And again, this is a character that could have been played very kind of, well, kind of just a boring cliche, like, oh, she's the cold, aloof, female, just, spouting out statistics and but doesn't know what it's like to be blah blah whatever. And they never really let her be that. There's always something more to her. That one episode, is it the oddly short episode, if I'm remembering it correctly? Because there's like one episode that for some reason is just like 35 minutes long, which was really.
Yeah.
I love that they could. I love that the format wasn't chained to always like, okay, we need to always be like 49 or 52 minutes. Like, nah, we'll do a 35-minute episode. What the heck? But I think that might be the one where a lot of the screen time or focus is on her character, if I'm not mistaken. I might be wrong, but I think it's that one. And we find out so much more about her, and maybe I had anticipated the possibility of what we found out about her personal life, but I just found the whole thing very fun and interesting to watch. But what I think helps the show be surprising for us is we went into a show, all we really knew was, oh, it's about something about FBI agents and serial killers. Hey, and David Fincher's got something to do with it. So we go into the show, I think we're going for plot. It's like, oh, it's going to be a plot-driven show because it's, catch the killers kind of a thing. And what made it interesting is, it's less plot driven than it is character driven, because either it's the people we just mentioned or even the killers themselves. I mean, the breakout character of the series turns out to be not any of the people we just mentioned. Turns out to be the killer Edmund Kemper. I think he's, if there's one guy who, one person on the series who I think has a legitimate shot at getting, say, you know, award nominations or recognition anywhere, I'm not just talking about the Emmys, it's that actor. He's so good on it. It's that's for me where the show all of a sudden felt, oh, this is a different tier show than I was giving it credit for initially. Because even his first scene, you're just like, oh, I gotta watch this, you know?
But this is definitely coming off of, like, you know, if like they did Silence of the Lambs in like a Mad Men style, where it's just, you know, a period piece with, like, you know, just the plot just kind of tumbling from one episode to the next, and, you know, all a bunch of, you know, interesting characters, and it's just kind of, you know, it feels like that to me.
That's actually a great analogy for it. That's because that's when we used to talk about Mad Men back in the day, so many years ago. That was one of our observations, is that Mad Men, while there certainly is plot, it's always going to be more of a character-driven show and learning more about the characters as they develop and evolve over time. And that's what we just saw with Mindhunter. Wow, I can't believe I didn't think of that, man. Man. If Mad Men was about murderers. Okay. I'm trying to think of where I wanted to go with this. So, now, let's just focus a little bit on that last episode. So, as I mentioned before, Holden has that huge panic attack, mental breakdown, whatever it is. I could see them going either way with that. I mean, it doesn't impact him that much. Obviously, if he had an actual breakdown, we could start off season two where he's actually in some sort of facility of some kind. So maybe they won't want to go that far. Here's one big question. Based on what he had done leading up to that first that last episode, and then what he does in that last episode, where he tells off those guys in the Office of Professional Responsibility, he kind of burns his relationships with his colleagues, whatever. I know it's a TV show, and so we have to take some liberties with things, whatever. How does this guy keep his job for the second season in that position? I'm assuming he has to, but how is that going to work?
He's definitely, with the bureaucracies, I'm sure there's a fair amount of red tape involved when it comes to, you know, firing somebody or putting them into suspension or whatever, but you would think that with how douchey and the god complex he seems to have, it would probably be doable if they really tried. Of course, the fact that he's good at the work, and then they're you know, continuing to get publicity for the work, that might, you know, be something where there'll be some kind of bad case, and then that they just think they need his help on, and they'll be able to use that to get him to do it. I don't know.
Yeah, I guess I hope they can figure out a way to do it that A, doesn't ignore what happened, because that would be a little bit frustrating to me. But also B, doesn't become something where we're like, really? That's what it is? This has felt so real, and then you just made like a comic book kind of idea. You know, like, oh, he's the only one who can help us here. Oh, but he's going to make a deal to come back. Like, no, don't do that. So, I mean, again, I've always said about writing for television in general, the best things you do are you come up with an idea by the end of a season or end of an episode where you're left wondering, well, how the hell do you get out of this? You know, that was something that, you know, either be Breaking Bad or even when it was really good, Lost would do from time to time. Like, well, how do they get out of this one? And that's what they've kind of done with that character. Like, where do you go with this character now?
Yeah, I'm getting the impression we probably won't see a ton more of his, well, I guess now ex-girlfriend, which is a bit of a shame since I like that character. Just doesn't seem like there would be much of a reason to keep her around since, you know, he's just such an asshole. I'm hoping that, even though I like to see the actress, she's doing good work, I'd hate to see that character give a douchebag Holden another chance.
Well, Maybe somehow between seasons one and seasons two, his character can evolve somewhat, and maybe he becomes less of a douche, but and maybe his meltdown is his kind of,
A
he'll
catharsis.
re yeah he'll reemerge from that. I agree. His girlfriend, Debbie, I think her name was.
Yeah.
I thought she was a great character. Definitely one of many really well-written female characters I've seen over the last several months. A bunch of them are on Netflix series, actually, quite frankly. But I guess because while there was always that little part of me that wondered how much I should buy her tolerating his douchey dorkiness at times, but then I realized, okay, she kind of there's something endearing about it to her at least, and it really does work for a lot of their scenes, but just a very smart, interesting character. Kind of reminded me a little bit. I know you didn't watch it, so it won't mean anything to you, but some of our listeners might have. Reminded me of one of the female leads on the HBO series of The Deuce that was on over the summer. And for anyone, and I'm not going to remember the character's name, but it'll be easy to distinguish which one I'm talking about. Probably the one woman on the show who was neither who did not work as in hooker as a hooker or in porn, or at least not yet. But just the same kind of 70s, but very smart, independent spirit, but not to the point of being kind of a goofy flake or something. So those these just. Maybe even smarter than the men that they're dealing with, up to a certain point. So it just reminded me of that character. I'm just not remembering that character's name right now. But yeah, I wish there was a way they could figure out to bring her back, but you don't want it to do something where it wouldn't be true to her character. I love their breakup. Their breakup was one of the better ones I've seen on television, quite frankly.
Yeah. And I mean, that's a character that seems that has, a decent rapport with Anna Torv's character and has some knowledge of like sociology and stuff. So maybe at some point in the future she'd be like, in the same league to do that kind of thing, but probably not.
Yeah, I agree. There's probably just not a way to do it that wouldn't be kind of like goofy.
And yeah, it'd be really manufactured and just wouldn't feel like, this show just doesn't feel like that kind of show. If it
Right.
was like The Flash or something, they would all know Barry's identity by now, and they would totally make it away if it happened, but.
Just had to take a shot at the Flash, didn't you? So another thing I was just wondering about while we're chatting it up here was and then now it just boomed right out of my head right when I was trying to say it. Oh, so another thing about what they do over the course of the season, and by the time we get to the end, I mean, douchey or not, we do definitely see Holden's character go through some sort of transformations as the show goes on. There are things he does later in the season that you cannot imagine. I cannot imagine a character doing in the first couple of episodes. So,
Right.
and I think, but what's interesting is another character, going back to Edmund Kemper. Every time we see him before that final episode, despite the fact that when we hear about the horrific things he's done, the murders and the graphic and just truly, truly horrible things he's done, but there's something so I don't know if likable is quite the right word. I know I overuse a word like that anyway. But there's something very compelling about him. And you kind of, maybe we do kind of like him up to a point. We look forward to those scenes and whatever. He's not, we don't, he doesn't, despite his discussion of the acts he's committed, I'm not thinking when I'm watching those scenes, oh my God, this guy's the epitome of evil. I just think, oh, he's troubled. He's done really bad things. But I don't think of him the same way, like if you're watching some, like a Lecter type, to use a fictional character or something like that.
No, I mean both him and Lecter, they really have this like kind of a magnetic pull on you, but Lecter's more of like a feral animal, and Kemper is just kind of like a, I don't know, like you're just sitting there like looking at a waterfall or something like that. There's just something kind of like soothing and peaceful, and like it's like almost monotone voice in the way he's speaking and relating information and providing solid information.
Right.
as well, intelligent person.
Which, and that's what makes that final scene with him that much more kind of creepy.
Oh yeah.
Because now I think that's the first time, despite the fact we've been told through his own, you know, by him, not to mention any other characters on the show, about what this man has done. I don't feel it's until that final scene where you realize, oh, he's very dangerous. he is actually very scary. Oh,
yeah, you really feel the menace in that scene where all of a sudden it's just like, oh, right, this guy's like, you know, really bad shit.
Right, exactly. And that's, and I think, although that's not, I would say it's less, it's not so much about a transformation for his character, it's more of a further reveal, and it's almost like a reminder, like, oh, did you forget what this guy actually is? And it reminds me of when I've watched different television series over the years, and especially shows that focused a lot on a character that was, you know, the quote unquote, you know, anti-hero or something. So then when you get to a point later on, either in a season or even in an overall series, and they've done, you know, horrible, unspeakable things, and sometimes you're left shaken by it, and you kind of want to, like, tap the person on the shoulder or yourself and say, did you forget who you were focusing on? Did you forget who you were dealing with? It's like when you watch the I think most people who watch or listen to this podcast have watched the show The Shield. I know you have. Yep. So, but I'll still gloss over certain details. It's like when you get to a certain point in that show towards the end where you're really confronted with the magnitude of just how corrupt or how many bad things the main character has done, you kind of like, they kind of told you that in the very first episode.
Yeah,
they weren't hiding it. In this show, they weren't hiding what Kemper did. We heard about it. It was pretty bad. Really bad. I mean, there are things, because I'm attempting a no cursing policy for this podcast. But I probably will, I'm sure. But what he does regarding his mother and her head and whatnot, that alone.
Yeah, even I wouldn't do that, and I'm capable of, you know, really insane depravities at times. People
well, that's
assume
that's well that does explain all the travels.
Yeah,
but that's what I really loved about that moment on the series. It was kind of like, and I would say it was one of the things I did think would fall under the category of brilliant for me. It's like, oh, I love that they did that, and it's kind of like, you know, shaking you about what the show was really about and who these people are. It's like, this is what he can do, you know.
Yeah, Holden Ford's having a really bad day, and I just, you know, and I just love the way he manages to look both comforted and totally creeped out at the same time when he's getting hugged there.
Oh, it's just, that's so, you know, it's so good. It's
oh,
so damn good. and I think we also delight in it. We delight in his discomfort because we ourselves might be having our own issues with Holden. I mean, obviously, I think some viewers probably will like him more than others. I mean, maybe I might like him a little bit more than you do, but he's still a fascinating character regardless. But and again, I might like him like a degree more, not much more, whatever. So in a show where we've got these things with these mass murderers, or then they come up with the concept of serial killers and all these, you know, these localized crimes that they help with, you know, help solve, you know, one way or the other. I gotta say, and I think a lot of people watching the show might agree on this one, it's kind of funny and kind of strange that by the time you get to the end of it, one of the biggest mysteries is about the cat.
Huh.
What's the story with the cat? It's one of those things that I think if you don't really think about it that much, then you don't. I mean, if you don't give it any thought at all, it's like, oh, she heard a cat, she left food for it, and then one day she put the food out, and the cat was gone. Whatever.
Yeah.
And if you just look at it that way and don't give it much thought, it's like, I will just look at you and say, they wouldn't keep putting those scenes in the show, you know, if it didn't have any other meaning beyond that, because that's just stupid.
Huh.
That doesn't make, there would be no point to it then. There's
it was a good excuse to have David Fincher do a really awesome, creepy, like, tuna can covered with maggots shot, which was really, you know, that was pretty disgusting, but a really nice shot. But yeah.
I'm going to assume it wasn't Fincher didn't go, okay, but we're going to have multiple scenes through our few episodes where she's feeding this cat. And mind you, she's feeding a cat that we will never see. We will never see the cat. We'll hear a cat, but we'll never actually see a cat. And then, because, you know, I got this idea, because one time I was feeding my cat, you know, this tuna egg crap. And I was thinking, with the rice in it. It's like, oh, why would they put rice in cat food? It looks like maggots. Wait a minute. I've got an idea. So I was thinking about it because if you want to get a little surreal with it, and I'm not saying that's what they're doing here. If you want to get a little surreal with it, you could wonder if there ever was a cat to begin with. And it was this just something, you know, playing in her mind, you know?
Yeah.
And, because, you know, and just because the tuna's gone doesn't mean any form of wildlife could have come and eaten whatever the food was. Whatever. Yeah. I'm not going to go that far. Cause that just...
No, I think we saw the can move at one point, too, when she walked away. Like, I think it moved a little bit.
Oh, but, you know, it could have been a raccoon.
Yeah. Well,
maybe. Could have been a rat. But it's really, I think it's more about, okay... What is this cat representing for this character? And there's also the little creepy reminder, I think, when the cat suddenly isn't there anymore. What's always one of the very common traits we tend to hear about serial killers is that they tend to, when they're younger, they tend to practice on, you know, cats and dogs. So I thought it was interesting, this woman who's become, you know, such a leading pioneer with the behavioral sciences and tracking down serial killers that, you know, she's suddenly caring for this invisible cat who then disappears. And it was like, I wonder if someone killed the cat. I'll admit part of me was expecting to find, to see a can of maggot ridden tuna. I was kind of wondering if I was going to see a dead cat at some point, which I was not looking forward to, but I was like, okay, Netflix, Can we limit it to one dead cat a show a year? Because I don't need to see another one, because another major show on Netflix did feature a dead cat. Spoiler for people who haven't seen Stranger Things yet. But
we can handle dead children left and right, as we'll talk about in a future podcast. But don't be killing the cats. You know?
So one of the things I do know about the show has been renewed. It's definitely got its second season. And I do think... And I do believe what you said before probably was a major factor. I mean, having David Fincher involved.
Yeah, I looked it up too. The other person that surprised me was Charlize Theron was one of the producers on the show too.
Oh, okay, cool.
Which is just like, okay. But maybe she does that kind of stuff sometimes. But either way, it's just another way to add gravitas to this whole Netflix experiment of cranking out stuff.
Well, it's funny with Netflix. I mean, I know on... this season on South Park, they've kind of goofed on Netflix a bunch of times where it seems like Netflix will just greenlight any show. When they answer the phone, they're Netflix, you're greenlit. How can I help you? And I'm like, really? What about my TV show? I'm trying to write. Damn it. But I like to think that Fincher was what got them to open the door and give them a shot for the first season. And then they just saw the reception and the quality of the show. And they're just going to, I think they'll just go with it until it's over. I think the show will continue on. It's definitely one of those. And if it does get any awards bait for them, even more likely. And maybe it'll help fill the hole that, you know, because House of Games is going to be gone after this coming season, and the tarnish that show has left due to the whole Kevin Spacey situation.
Yeah, maybe it'll get the House of Cards awards instead, but yeah, I don't know. But I think Fincher has definitely set up a good visual style for the show too, because the episodes that aren't directed by him, I mean, there is not a big drop off in quality, which is nice. I'm a big Fincher fan. I believe you're into his stuff too. So.
Oh yeah, well, it's nice
it's nice to see that style.
It was also great that they got him to direct. If I'm not mistaken, he directed both the first two and the last two episodes. So.
Yeah, that's a pretty significant chunk. Didn't he just direct one episode of House of Cards? I can't remember if he did the first couple or something, but
either way. I think he directed the first one. It's possible he either directed the second one or the final episode of the first season. I don't remember, but he may have only just done the first one. I know that's a thing that's been a thing for several years, where if you get a big name director attached as like a producer, they'll also come in and maybe direct the pilot. And that, like, Scorsese's done that a couple times with HBO series. I believe he directed the pilot for Boardwalk Empire, and I think he, I'm pretty sure he directed the pilot for Vinyl. So he, one great show and one not so great show. So, one of the few things I do know about the second season, other than the fact that I think they're going to get to it a lot faster than we expect, we might not have quite as long a wait for it as we normally do for these shows, but we'll see. One of the killers are going to, or one of the killings they're going to be focusing on is going to be the Atlanta child murders that happened over the course of a few years from 1979 to 1981.
Oh boy.
So that tells us, number one, we're going to get a few years in one season, so there may be some time jumping involved. Not as much as what I was talking about earlier, but still there has to be some. And God, the Atlanta child murders, I remember that case up to a certain point. I was a little young at the time, but I did not take the time to look it up online, but I remember it being a very high number as far as the number of kids that were killed. I could be wrong about that. I don't want to get a fact like that wrong. I don't suppose you happen to remember. You don't probably
No, that's not something I know much about.
that.
I know a fair amount of the exploits of my peers, but this is not one that I'm a big expert on. I'm more of a Midwest kind of guy.
Not so much the Southeast.
Now, too many of those confusing, those yellow cars that drive around towns that I just don't understand big city life.
Well, that's one of those cases where there was a definite number and possibly more kind of things. There's a lot that tends to be the case with a lot of these major serial killers who, unless they've come out and confessed to everything by the end of it, and quite often they don't, or they lie, whatever. There's always going to be that certain number that you're not sure for, were if they're missing or if they're murdered or if they were committed by this person or not. With the Atlanta child murders from 79 to 81, what I'm seeing online, there were anywhere from 25 to 31 victims. So,
Oof.
definitely dealing in, not that it's about keeping score, but definitely dealing in higher numbers than the killer that they encountered here in the first season, who you tended to have killers who had killed, I think Kemper had killed 10. I mentioned earlier that they speak to Richard Speck in it, and so that's also another Mad Men connection. Because if I'm not
Yeah.
mistaken, there's one episode of Mad Men where the characters they're all obsessing over the Richard Speck murders, where he had taken prisoner and killed, I think it was like eight student nurses or something like that. So, yeah, I'm not watching the show just wondering, oh, I wonder which killer they're going to do next. Or, well, maybe they'll get someone to play David Berkowitz and he will get to interview him or something.
No, but it's definitely something where, like, with the way the show has been done so far, we've seen them. I mean, they're working on cases that are pretty much, one-off murders, for the most part, and they're talking to people that are already, like, incarcerated, but they aren't really dealing with an active serial killer and having to, like, apply what they've learned to a, like, a live situation that continues to escalate. So you can just imagine, like, with a show where the characters are already pretty stressed out and not exactly getting along well, if they're actually doing a case where they're trying to figure it out and the body count starts to rise and it's a bunch of kids and stuff. I mean, that's you can just imagine it's gonna be real. I'm trying not to swear too much too, but
It's okay.
something.
There
It'll be a shit show, but good.
you go. Yeah, I wonder. I mean, I think one of the things they're trying to be careful about is, since these two characters are not the actual agents that they're inspired by or based on, so maybe they're also trying to whatever extent, avoid them being quote unquote like directly involved with the capture or taking down of any actual known killer. It's like those shows like Boardwalk Empire that I just mentioned. That was a show that dealt with mostly real character, people from actual history, and then you threw in a bunch of characters who obviously didn't exist, And the one thing you had to be careful was like, okay, but you can't have anyone do something that is a bit over the top where like, okay, that guy can't kill Al Capone. That's not what happened. You know,
yeah.
Like that kind of, you know what I mean? So I think maybe that's one of the things so the convention of the show of they're interviewing and seeing these actual killers, but the cases that they get involved in, the more localized cases, are not actual people. That, I think, is how they can get away with that. So I don't... If season two is going to feature the Atlanta child murders, whether or not they're going to have any hand in solving that case or not, or it's something that they're maybe obsessing about, but they never actually have anything to do with or any real connection to, I don't know. It's one of the mysteries of what they're going to do with this series. Another odd thing about the show overall, when you start digging into the history of it, is this is actually based on a lot of this is based on a book that was published back in 1988. And which is funny. I think the book is Sexual Homicide or Sexual Homicide something, like Patterns and Motives, I think. But that book was published in 1988, and I mentioned earlier in the podcast that they're dribbling facts about one of the more well-known serial killers who, over a long period of time, who wasn't caught until the early 90s. So, but my assumption is, well, they're using the book as their basis to start, but if they want, just like other shows that we watch, they can go beyond the book. You know, that's where the book ends, but they can go beyond the book to tell more of a story. But then you fall into the rabbit hole of, but they can't be the ones who catch the BTK killer because he's an actual guy. You know, that you can't do that. You can at best make him the FBI who consults on it, but they can't be the ones who catch the guy.
But, right. I mean, you know, you can, yeah, because once you start using actual historical characters, I mean, you really can't have these guys totally meddle with the, you know, what's going on. I mean, I suppose you could, but it would end up feeling a little bit odd.
Oh, right. Yeah. I mean, basically, you can't do a Tarantino and shoot Hitler is usually what I say.
Yeah.
Which I remember when I said that in the theater, I just went, wait, what the hell is going on? I mean, I loved it, but I was like, this is crazy. Oh, and back to really quickly, because speaking of the BTK killer and the whole fact that the creator of Silence of the Lambs and so on, Thomas Harris, his character, Will Graham, was in many ways based on the Johnny Douglas in real life. I believe Thomas Harris also said that the Francis Dollar-Eyed character, to a certain extent, was based, I think, on the BTK killer. At least that was one of the inspirations for that character, if I'm not mistaken. I think I'm right about that. I probably have it written down somewhere. I'm just trying to find it right now. I could have sworn I wrote that down. Maybe I didn't write it down. Whatever. Yeah. But, and another great thing about the show is that it's... This is one of those shows that I think really works well for the whole binge mentality that seems to have run amok in this country over the last few years especially. But again, it does it in an interesting way and not in the more obvious way where, you know, having the show like end on a little cliffhanger, like, oh, I got to watch the next one. I got to eat another potato chip. This show doesn't necessarily really do that by and large. And that's, I think, to its credit. It just makes me want to know more about the characters and pursue them more. So I would, so it makes me want to go to the next one. And that was tough for me because I was originally watching this with a couple friends, and we were going to just watch one episode a week, like we had done with a couple other series earlier this year. And I think we mutually discovered like, yeah, we got to watch a few of these on our own. And then I can, you know, conveniently air quotes got sick. I was like, yeah, I'm just going to watch the whole thing. As well as a bunch of other shows, but that was the one I was like, oh, I really want to finish watching Mindhunter. I've got a podcast. I got to finish watching it for my best of. Yeah, that's a ticket.
Yeah, it would have made my top 10 if I had watched it last year. But I guess now it can make my top 10 for 2018, so woo! No, it can't.
No.
I guess it's probably...
I like that. I always get hung up on the rules of that, either be our own
Our
podcast or when,
own arbitrary rules.
or even I even apply those rules when I want. Like, for example, one of the group pages that we're both members of, like, someone will post a poll about people picking their favorite television series of 2017. And I had no interest in voting on it because I figured I did my part already. I don't need to do this all over again. So, but I always find myself, and this happens every year, I look at the choices. I'm curious what people, what suggestions they put in there. And I have to, oh, what?
I'm curious how dumb these people end up being too, but go ahead.
Well, my thing, no, I'm not even gonna go with the God, really, that show kind of thing. Of course, whatever, everybody watches something because otherwise, no, otherwise those shows wouldn't be on at all, but the I have to restrain the assholish, anal retentive, and I guess I just use those two things combined there, which is fascinating, qualities about myself when I see someone post a show that did not come out in 2017. But they're bringing, and it's unfair of me because, like, for example, one of the shows that's listed there is the, I never know if it's pronounced the OA or the OI. It's probably the OA. I don't remember. And you know what? Probably most people who didn't do an immediate binge of that show or a quick binge of the show probably did end up watching it in 2017 because it came out in December of 2016.
Yeah, I remember a lot of people watching in January, so.
Yeah, and I, but I'm still like, that's not a 2017 show. If you're gonna put that, then you might as well put a show. Hey, I watched The Wire for the first time this year. I'm putting that in the list. And probably, I'm sure someone probably put Lost on that there somewhere. Tickets
Well,
off.
such popularity contest group polls are, they're always, by their own nature, inferior to our well thought out lists that you and me do. So, which is why I don't never take them too seriously. I mean, I added three Guy Fieri related cooking shows to the list, so obviously I'm not taking.
God, I just tried this. I think I saw that. All right. So, I would say that, this definitely was a. Here's one last question then before we get to wrapping this up. It's an interesting thing, and it's maybe it's because of the Netflix phenomenon, whatever. Do you feel, and like I was watching it once a week for the first couple episodes, and then had a re then resorted to a binge way. Do you think this is a show that works better? Could it work? Would it work better as a once a week show, or do you think it's better as a Netflix where you can watch a bunch at a time and maybe knock it out in a weekend or over the course of a few days?
I don't know. I mean, I think it just depends on how well we're able to restrain ourselves. I mean, because I've considered that this year it might be interesting to try to take one of these Netflix shows and we could just try to do it over a course of 10 weeks and only watching one. But with a show like this or some of the other ones we'll probably be talking about it, when the show is really good, it's hard to do that when we have the option to just, I
Right.
mean, yeah.
I think that's a very difficult thing to try to do because especially if you're going to do a podcast as well, because
Yeah,
then
but then
you're
we're forcing the listeners to adhere to our own,
and then
way of watching it too.
and yeah, great. We'll get like three people who are going to do that, and everyone else will be like, no, I'm just going to watch it. But it's an interesting idea, but it'll be a bit harder. It might be it's one of those great in theory, but might be harder to pull off kind of
No.
ideas.
One thing I do with like shows when I'm behind on them, but I listen to a podcast for the show. I mean, I'll keep them in my iTunes until I get caught up in the show, and then I have those so I'll listen to their reactions as I was watching blah
Right.
blah episode or Mr. Robot or whatever. I do that fairly often if it's people that I actually like and get along with, like if you're covering something with whoever or Jay and Jack or Mike Moody, whoever, I'll let these podcasts pile up until I make the time to watch the shows, and then
Right.
at some point I'll listen to them. So yeah, it was a good show. You made a good, very good recommendation, so thank you for that. I think after we recorded our marathon podcast last time, it didn't take me long to start watching this, and I'm pretty sure I was at least a few episodes into it until I before I actually finished it doing the production work on that last podcast. So
Right.
I got hooked pretty well, and I was not disappointed with the experience at all.
Yeah, I would say for based on the shows that we tend to enjoy, this is one of those shows that really worked on multiple levels, both in terms of character and story, performance, directing, cinematography is great on the show.
Setting, I love that 70s music and stuff. I mean, they just were rocking it. I mean, really, really, really solid.
Yeah, this works on a lot. It's hitting on all cylinders. Of course, it's debatable the jarring way they whatever, you know, they tell us the location has to be in those gigantic brick, gigantic. Too big for the screen font when we were watching.
It works for Preacher, but it might be a little weird for this, I guess. I mean, it's definitely different than X-Files, just dropping a little bit of font at the bottom of the screen.
It's one of those things where I almost want to do like a video based on how all these different shows do the location font and how they do it. Because, X-Files, we just have the little thing on the bottom of the screen. Or what you just said about Preacher, of course, does that, which is kind of insane. The show Alias would do this thing where, you know, the letters would zoom in at you, but we'd see the location through the letters kind of a thing, so they got really arty with it all the time. It was just one of those kind of like, oh, okay, thank you, like, Wichita, Kansas. I wish they would, like, dub in a voice like that every time. You know, Dearborn, Michigan, you know.
It's like when I see a flash in the screen, I think of, like, you know, like, oh, are they advertising, like, a monster truck rally? Saturday, come down to Wichita Falls.
Sunday. kill your mom. And anyway, wow. Okay, time to stop. Did I have anything else? Was there anything else? No, I think we can. It was really great, fun show. I hope people gave it a shot and this they had a reason to listen to this podcast. Probably didn't warn people. I guess no one's going to listen to this podcast if they haven't watched the show already, so I'm not going to worry about any spoilers. So screw that.
Plus, we can advertise the me being a serial killer connection, and then maybe that'll get somebody to watch the show and then listen to this. So that'll help. It's just, you want to watch a show that was like free therapy for Dan? Because he learned a lot about himself watching the show. But his mother locks the door at night now.
Well, yeah, and somehow you guys only have butter knives to cut things with in the house, so, you know, good luck with that. Oh. But Dan's like, I know how to sharpen. Come on. All I need is a rock. So on that not so disturbing note, and even saying that is kind of more disturbing now that I said it out loud, if you enjoyed this podcast, chances are you'll enjoy hanging out on our Facebook page. By the way, even though I'm doing the wrap-up here, I had an idea, and it's kind of a thing that people do with podcasts all the time. We never have expressly done it, and I thought about doing it for these two this podcast and the next one that we're going to be doing shortly. So I'm just going to put it out to the few folks who listen and also communicate with us on our Facebook page. Would you guys sometimes like a heads up on what our next podcast is going to be if you want to ask any questions or whatever? One person I will avoid, their questions will be ignored, but everyone else is fine, or their observations, whatever. Or do you not care about that sort of thing?
No, I prefer to get, you know, other than the inane prattlings of one specific person, I'm more than fine soliciting feedback from the intelligent listeners we have.
Yeah, I was wondering about doing it. I mean, I think... I'll be honest, the reason why I haven't necessarily done that in the past as much, it's because, well, on our Facebook page, you know, it's nice that we have, you know, X number of members, and, you know, either there are people who are friends of you, or friends of me, or friends of other people that have joined, which is nice. When you're looking at a page where it tends to be just a certain select number of people who are the people who tend to talk or comment, I don't know if we want to have a podcast where it's always like the same... you know, peanut gallery of commenters. Then again, if they've got something really good to say, it still might be worth it. So
yeah, and it's the kind of thing too where, like, you know, if it'll bring up other topics of conversation for us too, which is always nice to have.
Yes, and I will also let you do all the reading of those. That way, people can get a break from hearing me, you know, yap for too long as I tend to do on these things. So it's a win-win for everybody if we do it that way. Take some of the pressure off of us trying to come up with what the heck we're going to say. So, yeah, I mean, I'm thinking that maybe we might do that in the future. But if anyone, you know, feels strongly about a really, you know, is in favor of it, you know, let us know on the thread on the on our Facebook page for this podcast, and that'd be good. Of course, if no one's watched Mindhunter yet, then none of those people are going to comment on the thread, so I don't know. Anyway, but if you enjoy this podcast, you'll enjoy hanging out on our Facebook page. It's the Serious TV Drama Podcast page. Like the page and join the conversation. You can also find us on iTunes the very same way, the Serious TV Drama Podcast. You can type that in, subscribe to our feed, and please, it would be nice to get some more ratings and reviews. Obviously, we have some nice numbers there, but we wouldn't mind a few more because that's been kind of frozen in those numbers for a year now. And finally, when I remember to use it, we do have a Twitter feed. It's at STVD Podcast. That's STVD as in Serious TV Drama Podcast. That's where I will send out links to the actual podcast. And every once in a blue moon, maybe our feed will choose to comment on something. Maybe that might happen more often this year, so it might be a reason to subscribe. Not subscribe. What's the word? Follow? Yeah, follow our... Wow, I'm showing my age and then some. Follow our Twitter tweeting account, whatever. Huh. We won't be threatening any North Korean dictators either while we're at it. So, that's it. I was going to say at the beginning of the podcast, I think we can get this done in roughly an hour, but I didn't want to jinx us. And look at that. We just made it just around an hour. So we did good for a change. How about that?
Yeah. Well, don't jinx this because we're not done.
I'm not talking about that one, so this doesn't count. Don't create the jinx. Anyway, it was great talking to you, and I hope you guys, after you enjoyed watching Mindhunter, I hope you enjoyed listening to this podcast as well, and I don't know, have a good night.
Good night, everybody.